please tell us a little bit about where you grew up and a little bit about your early years?
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Is it good?
Okay. My name is Martijn Bakker, and I was born a very long time ago, close to Amsterdam, in the Zaanstreek of the industrial centers. And I come from a printing family background. It was my youth, my early years. I divided between the Zaanstreek and Bergen near Alkmaar, which is a seaside, more or less a seaside town, which was very nice. What else do you need to know? Do you want to know more about me as a baby?
Whatever you feel comfortable sharing.
So I grew up there, I studied there, and then I consequently went to Amsterdam, where I finished studying print management and started working in the printing company of the family, which I did for a couple of years. I'm talking about the 60s, 70s, and in the 80s, I felt uncomfortable with managing 100 people there. Also, the technology was changing very fast, and as I'm, I think, more creative person, I started a new company. So we merged the printing company with another company, stayed there for a year, and then started an advertising agency in a new field of it was called direct marketing. I began an advertising agency, and during those years, when working in advertising, I met I think you need to ask me questions.
Sorry, we only have one mic, so we have to pass it back and forth. Well, you were once married to a woman, you have a son. They're both very special to you. Please tell us a bit about them and how do they feel about your leather involvement?
My son, my wife, yes, I've been married. Well, you see, I'm a product of the 60s, and the 60s were very different than what is life now, being gay, or when you grow up under present times, and when you grow up in the 60s. So, to give an example, I studied in Amsterdam, and I knew, that was before I was married, I knew I had this inclination for men, but you didn't know, and you heard things. So you were looking. There were some bars apparently, and one was in the Gravely Grey study, which was a very dark street at the time. And you would go out when you see pictures, it's unbelievable. You go out in a suit and in a tie, everybody, whether you are 16 or 18 or 20. So the pressure from not only the family, but also peer pressure from friends was quite substantial. And because you felt somewhere that you were different, but there were a few who resisted and were rebellious, and of course you were envious, but some could do it and some couldn't. What happened was that I was found out by my brother, who talked to my father, who talked to my mother, and I was sent to the local doctor. And of course, you want to please your mom, of course. In those days, you want to please your parents, and the doctor said, "Oh, that's just a phase, and that will which I wanted to believe. And then life is what has lots of sudden turns, and it's partly, of course, you direct your own life, but it depends on what choice you make, or what choice you make when you go left or right. And as it happened, my best friend told me that his sister was just 18 and he gave driving lessons, and it was so hilarious. And anyway, next time I came there, I came to the house, I looked at him, and we got on, and it's, and you're at an age where sexuality, any sexuality, is interesting. So that's why, in the end, I got married. And then, of course, it is like trying to put a lid onto boiling water. So the first year, the second year, you go, but then you notice that you start sort of lying, or at least thinking about different things. So one evening we went out to Tuszynski, the local cinema, and I had read a book of James Baldwin, which is a writer who partly wrote erotic novels. So my mind was already to see that book, and when we walked out of the cinema, I saw this book there. Oh, God. So I decided to tell her, and which was okay. So first you say you're bisexual, and then because you don't know yourself totally, although I think you know, but you don't want to know. We didn't divorce at that time because we were both young, 27, 24. And she wanted a child, I wanted a child, so a son was born. So there was no... Then it was decided that it was better to separate, because at least she would have a chance to remarry, being young, and which is what we did, we always kept contact. So my son slept between two men, because I met my first late husband now. Then he, so when he was not even 1 year old, he slept between two gay people. And when he was a student, he worked in the workshop of Rob, making anal balls with his best friend. So, to talk about whether they accept it, that's no, there's no point. I'm now a grandfather, and his first child was named after my second late husband. So, acceptance is there.
Yeah. Hopefully I don't shut this thing off. But, that's right, otherwise I'll end up creating a problem. When you were young, tell us about the first time you came.
Come. Hey.
Came, come.
Well, I didn't know that I came. Yeah, that was a nice, well, if you remember that. We did talk a lot, but I don't know what questions he distilled out of that. The printing company was a big complex, and we somehow, there was this empty room where there were two, what do you say, rings, gymnastic rings were hanging. And so I was playing with that, and one day I was pushing myself up with my hands, like straight, and I got this strange feeling. I thought, oh, what's happening? Quite nice. So let's do it again, and again, and again. So that was the first time. I was 11, I think, or 10, or whatever. Young.
I think one thing a lot of people would like to know, particularly younger people, is how the scene was back when you came out. Would you please depict the Amsterdam gay and leather scene for us as you knew it coming out?
I think there are probably other people who can do that better than I do. I think I want to, first of all, I think that leather is not the word, or SM, it is a combination of things. And I also feel that when you write, it's, they say being gay isn't a genius, and it's not an illness, and of course that's true. But I think it's also true that somehow BDSM, to use the term, is also somewhere in your genes. I don't think that when you are not into BDSM or you have no affinity with it, that somebody can persuade you to do that. When they persuade you, then it must have been in you already, the interest. So, since I was young, I felt that not only that I was gay from boys, but there was this leather, was interesting and sort of, well, what do you like to say, kinky side of it. And I dabbled in that. My nephew played, and I played with a school friend. Of course, we're not gay, we said, we're not into these kind of things, so just playing. When I went to Amsterdam and you discover the scene, you don't know where to go. It's a different time than what it is now. So you are searching for something. You don't know what you are totally exactly searching for. And I met this guy who picked me up. Yes, those were the days. He picked me up. We had sex in the car. And then he said, "Do you want a drink? I know a good bar." And yeah, okay. Even have been when I was married, so I didn't have lots of time. But he brought me to the Argos, which I later knew it was the Argos. I didn't know it was the Argos. So there was the Argos in the Hanje Hoekstraat. And we got into the bar. And I thought, geez. So I got one bar. I put one drink and I was out again. As I said, I've noticed that with people coming to rock young people as well, they come into the shop, they look like this, and they go to the end of the shop, and then they walk straight out, and then 3 months later they come and they chew things. So yeah. And that's how that was my first contact, my first discovery with what I didn't know was the leather community, if we may say, if we can describe it as that. So, we're talking about 72, 3, 4, somewhere in that period. And the scene, if you can speak of the scene, it concentrated. The Argos was the center, I think, at that moment. No, not the Argos. What I soon found out, because there were leaflets, was the MSA, Motor Sport Club Amsterdam, seemed to be the fraternity, the secret society, the sort of, ooh, wow, that's where it is. So it was a totally different scene from the scene we know now.
Why was it so different?
Well, the difference is that I think when you are young, and that is at any time, whether I was young, whether people were young in the 50s or 60s or 70s, or even people who are now 15, when you realize that you have a different feeling, so that you are a bit different from other people, you search. And you don't know, and especially in the 70s and the 60s, you don't know where to go. So you follow people when you check. And then you come into something which you think this is it. And then hopefully for you, you meet some responsible people when you play who can take you further. Every encounter, you learn, at least most people, some people never. And the difference between the 70s and the 60s and now is that you still don't know where to go, but you Google and you know where to go. So there is no, an old man talks here, where you had this oh, you got sick in your stomach of tension, things like that, which I think nowadays young people will still get it, but there is, it's a much shorter period between I want this or this. Am I not the only one? And to find out that there are lots of other people.
Absolutely. When we were preparing for this chat and we were doing your pre-interviews and talking about topics, we spoke about the cultural differences between the European and the US leather scenes. They are very, very different. Would you please depict those for us?
Yeah, it's an interesting, and of course, I cannot prove this, so it's my own assumption. Well, I think the Americans, they like to go to Europe because we play, and we also have the uniforms, which is, whether we admit it or not, part of why this all developed. And where in America they, or in the US, they are more theoretical, they organize themselves like it's almost like a handbook on how to be a good leatherman. And in Europe we have less of that. So they think, because the uniforms are in Europe, that we are even more regimented. And then they find out that we play more without rules, but it's a different structure, it's a less structured life than the Americans, I think. And you can see that in clothing. When we sell, Americans don't mind whether trousers are wide or whatever, they buy it. So clothing is less important for them. Where for us, if it is, if it doesn't, well, okay, let me not start. there is a problem. So yes, there are cultural differences, and I think that is the Leatherhand book has been written by Larry Townsend. Also, the lack of social security means that you need to stick together to survive far more in America than over here, although we go that way, it seems also a little bit. So yes, there are cultural differences.
What's the biggest cultural difference you personally?
See, for us in Europe, all the porn videos came from America. So we thought there are all these hungry men, and you can have sex in America. You have sex 24 hours a day, and when you come over there, you go to New York. That was my first experience. You think, okay, well, they're like us Europeans, so I should go to the West Coast. Well, that was a disappointment. So. Differences, I don't think we are, but differences are that there is more theoretical, there is more how to do things than here. So we learn from, hopefully learn from experience by meeting responsible tops, bottoms, whatever. And in America there is an emphasis on how to, and which is less here. I think that's my observation.
Stepping back slightly, you spoke a little bit about the MSA, and it features very prominently in your history. Would you please tell us about the MSA. What did they do? How did they impact you?
Well, I cannot say exactly what they do because I wasn't a board member. The MSA was basically a group of people, initially a group of people who assembled to have fun as gay men who were interested in leather or SM. And I think in 1973, I became number 29, and it grew at a time to 100, and then there was a schism because somebody voted that only people with a bike could be a member, whatever, like everywhere. But the main function of MSA, and they have for a very long time fulfilled that function, was being a living room, being a get-together, being a social contact for leathermen or for men into leather, as in. It was far more a friend, a club of friends, like who knew each other, and that over the years wasn't necessary anymore. So because you now have the internet and you have Google and you whatever, so the social function of the MSA, the need to have this social function for lonely people who at the time were not accepted, because let's not forget, in the 60s and the 70s, you couldn't walk, obviously, in a pair of leather trousers because you were, that was impossible. And slowly, with the acceptance of that and the acceptance of SM and BDSM, the need to have a social function to ask other people to help sort of diminished.
Well, Leather Pride Amsterdam is celebrating its 20th anniversary this year. That's a huge achievement. How did you and why did you create Leather Pride Amsterdam?
Well, why is a simple question. It's like with everything in life, you need to love what you do, you need the interest in what you do. Whether you are a carpenter, you need to love your trade, you need to like it, so that work is not something, it can be a hobby or whatever. And through my friendship with Rob over the years, I was sort of, should I say that, sucked into the leather scene. And then when Rob and his lover died in 1990, and I started to run the Rob shop, I got more involved into leather life, whatever that is. And then in 1995, I think the MSA had their 15th anniversary. I think 1997, yeah. Their 25th anniversary, and they organized that in the, what we now call the old arena, I think. At the time it was only, and it was an old, the buildings were an old convent. There was a restored convent with a, like a church with angels painted on the ceiling. There was a restaurant and there was a hotel. And this 35th anniversary was a huge success. And I thought, because at the time we had already business in America, and I had Leather Pride there, and of course there was Hamburg Leather Pride, and there was east there was Berlin, and I thought we should do something in Amsterdam. This is the perfect venue. So I asked one of our employees to, the next day, I said, go there and try to reserve the days in November, so that we didn't intervene with all the other parties, and try if it is possible to reserve these days. So we didn't know exactly what we would do, but it was important to have at least the days reserved so that we could do something. So that was basically the seed out of which Leather Pride Amsterdam was born. And from a very small thing, it went to over that year, it involved with other people, other businesses. I don't want to dwell on that, but ultimately, it, 1996 being the first Leather Pride was fantastic, I think. Yeah.
You mentioned, again, when we were preparing for this, that years ago, a lot of German tourists would come to Amsterdam to enjoy its much more liberal lifestyle and its laws. Would you please tell us a bit about that?
Well, Bobby, it's the old man again. What we forget nowadays is that it's not that long ago that going out as a gay man was not without any risk apart from sexual risks. When I went out to this bar I mentioned before for the first time, and which was probably somewhere, let me think, probably in the 60s. If you would come too close, stand too close to another man, although the bar was full, you would hear the barman say, "Denk om de gunsten," think about the favors we get, because officially it was forbidden to be, well, it was forbidden, the laws were against it, it was suddenly anti, suddenly it was everywhere in Europe. Very soon, within a couple of years, they in Holland, they lifted those bans, thanks to the work of many people, not me. But, and therefore, in people in Germany who still had these laws came to Amsterdam being a free city, of course, the cannabis marijuana started here and there. So the DOK, the dance club, was famous or infamous for other people, and they would come literally by busloads, organized buses came to Amsterdam. And the same was for leather people, because at the time you had Hamburg once a year, you had Berlin where there were more leather bars, but there was nothing. In London there was not, there was a back street where the owner would go around with a light to see that you wouldn't have sex. And in those days, and I know from friends, they would fly in, people would fly in to 10 times a year to have to come to Amsterdam purely because you could do it wrong.
Wow. Tell us about Rob. Who was he?
Well, over the years, of course, there are more and more people who had known him, and he has become a bit of a larger than life figure. He was either people loved him or they hated him, in whatever measure. He was a man with many faces, but who am I to say who was he? was a craftsman. He was a, you could call Bob a real fetishist. He was a leather, leather was his fetish. He didn't, rubber or whatever, leather was it. And he was also, he was thinking about this whole leather scene, the coming out. He helped a lot in people accepting the leather scene. And he wasn't afraid to, he probably liked it to cause controversy in public. But his he had very good views on that. So he was a very kind and intelligent man. It's a pity that he departed too early, I think. Yeah.
What kinds of controversies did he create?
Well, a little story. When I still worked for this printing company, we, instead of giving gifts for Christmas, we invited our customers once a year for a theater evening with their partners or whatever. And and my customers knew I was gay, I was open about it, but didn't know exactly, of course, what it was. That was already a bit shady. So I took Rob to this theater evening. So he would make an outfit for me in leather, which was of course a suit. I want to be nice, and he came in a sort of overall with cut off arms, with his tattoos here and there, and stirring controversy. But at the same time, of course, women loved it. The customer was sort of, well, what is this? But it helped to bring out in the open the diversity of gay people, because we must not forget that in the 60s and 70s, when you were gay, you were effeminate. When my wife and I split up about a year later, she said, I think that my brother saw you walking on the street with these white gloves or whatever, indicating sort of, I don't know, forget it, that's not okay. So there has been a sea change in thinking of what it means for gay people, and that they are like, okay. And he has worked very hard. He has been on television, of course. One of the things which, sadly, now was the HIV start. But it's another thing.
How did you come to own the Rob shop here in Amsterdam?
Well, that was because of HIV. What happened was that I met Rob in 1975, and he had just started his business, and I wanted to have him made something. And we got on like Housenard, so we talked, and one day we tried to have sex, which lasted 1 minute, I think. So, but we were each other's best friends. In 1984, my husband died, and it was a very nasty thing. He got a heart attack, came from Cologne. His parents were, anyway, a mess, not accepting gay people. And Rob and I said, God, this is. You don't think about dying when you're young. When he died at the age of 43. So we decided that he would become my executor and I would become his executor. And in the following years he married, or he couldn't marry of course, he met Di Evans, his long-life partner. And then in 1987 I lived in London. First Di was, well, we all said AIDS at the time because HIV was not invented, the term was not invented there. And about a year later, Rob was also diagnosed. And they both died in 1990. So I had promised to look out his shoulder. To ask yourself the question after a year or so, is that finished or not? And then from there on it started. So that's how I came to Rob.
You mentioned HIV impacting the community, but when it did, it also affected the sale of the Muir cabs at Rob. Would you tell us why?
Well, not only Muir cabs. But it was an interesting observation. Of course, what happened was that suddenly, within a couple of years, say 5 years, a whole, let's say the older people, like maybe, well, I wasn't that old at the time, they mainly survived. And then you had the very young people, but this whole middle, people between 20 and 40, 50 were sort of almost wiped out. And it means that the whole leather scene suddenly, I mean, you didn't have friends anymore, and I'd be lucky, very lucky, that I seem to have gone through that. But the leather scene was decimated, and therefore, people from 18, where normally you have younger people come into the scene and they meet other people and they slowly get interested in more and more experiences. They start to buy leather and then they get a mule cap, as an example. So the mule caps were, the sale of mule caps were dead because there was nobody there to buy them. There were no people anymore. And then suddenly in 95, 96, 97 or 2000 they started to pick up again. So you could see that the next generation was coming into play. Yes.
Well, you've also said that each employee of ROC is able to teach SM. What is that?
I think I've been a bit over-optimistic there. No, every employee, because I can think of some people working for Rob who don't do that. But let's say the people who mainly talk to our customers, they have experience, they are experienced, and they all have their own speciality. But we're into SM, we're into BDSM, and everybody who, everybody who works for Rob, which is not totally true, because we have women and women as well in the atelier, but people, our front people all like all into SM, and I think that's necessary because otherwise, you know, why would I do this? It's very important to love what you do and to be interested in what you do. At least that's my
thing. You were the last owner of the Argos, and that was truly a world-class leather bar. Why did that close?
Dismantled it, it didn't look very dark, you don't see that. The very simple reason, because people didn't come to the Argos anymore. So it's amazing how quickly that changed, and not only with the Argos everywhere. I think in 2011 it was still okay, and in 2012 you could see a dramatic, but more than dramatic, drop. And so with the start of the smartphone, and it's nowadays it's sort of an old habit to say that, but with the smartphone, internet has killed off the social aspect of the leather scene. And not only in Amsterdam, I think we're still lucky in Amsterdam, but everywhere. I mean, let's face it, we complain, but when you count the number of leather bars here, we come from a very large number of bars because Amsterdam was, or I don't know, was, but seemed to be, or was said to be, the gay capital. And as I said before, they came by the busloads to Amsterdam, so we had, I don't know, 7 leather bars, 8, well. And at the moment, we still have probably about 4, 5. In Berlin, they don't have 5 leather bars. In Paris, they don't have 5 leather bars. In London, Hoist closes, there's no leather bar. Well, there's the backstreet. So I think we can count ourselves lucky that we still have a leather bars with, and therefore can have a leather scene. But it all depends on people going out, people being active in the community. And unfortunately, like with everything, whether you have a football club or whatever, it depends on a few people who do that.
Drummer Magazine was an amazing teacher for you. How is that, and how did you come to own it?
Well, I seem to do something wrong, like buying the Argos, and then the internet starts, or the smartphone starts, and the same happened with Drummer Magazine. To go back, Drummer Magazine, when I was young, you had this these little magazines with nude men, the old-fashioned American womanizer things. And then suddenly you in the American bookstore, which was in the Kalverstraat, you could find Drummer Magazine. Wow. So there was nothing like Drummer Magazine. You had the publications from Denmark, Toy and SM and things, which were pictures, but here you had stories and things like that. So, for me at least, and I think for what I found for my generation, most people, Drummer was a beacon of BDSM sex. And I wasn't. Specifically interested in the magazine, to buy the magazine, but what happened was that we got a visit in 1993 from the sales manager from Drummer Magazine, and we had dinner, and during the dinner he invited me to come to San Francisco to be a judge at the Drummer Contest. Oh, that was 93, I think. And when I was there, so I was for the first time, I was in the West Coast, I talked to people, and then very soon you hear, well, they go bankrupt, and they're all there, and this and that. And they also had a small mail order company attached to where they sold all sorts of things. So then I started thinking. And the end of the story was that we bought the magazine. About 8 years later, and lots of money, internet came in 95, so we didn't get any adverts anymore. It was America far away. Let me not elaborate, but I've tried, but it was impossible to do that. So, yeah, it's like, unfortunately, I think.
I agree.
Perhaps I shouldn't do less work on thinking to save magazines or bars or whatever. The world changes.
When you judged IML some years ago, you said you felt like an outsider. Why did you feel like an outsider?
It sounds, maybe it sounds strange, because nowadays so many people go to the United States on holiday or for business. But not so long ago, not many people went to the United States. And it was a different world. When we had the drummer contest in the early 90s in San Francisco, the organizer of the IML talked to me and invited me to be a judge at IML, which coincided that year with the first contestant from, not the first contestant from Europe, but from Holland, I think, Henry ten Haven. And so I said, yes, I'll do that. So I had to be there on a Friday, say. And I flew in, and I got to the venue, and they were all busy, and I was there. And I didn't know how they organized it. It was a very, very close-knit American group of American people who were there, and they didn't have any time to brief me, and there I was sitting at that table and not knowing how. Nobody knew. Also, the Dutch people didn't know because there was no experience. And I felt an outsider. I felt being left out, more or less, which I don't mind, but it was not helpful at the time. It made a pleasure.
And when did you judge IML?
I think that was week and a half, 95, 6, 93. Oh, God, so, 93.
Glad other people assist. So. Okay. So, what are your thoughts regarding mentoring in the leather community?
Well, I think mentoring as such is a concept, at least I think it is a concept we don't know as in a structural way. It is not a concept we know in Europe. It may be in America, but I think that here again it is about structure and by book, etc. And I think in Europe when you come out and you find people to play with, you learn, at least when you're open. You hope that, hopefully, you'll meet responsible people who can teach you something, and that you are open, but you learn every day. So it's not mentoring as such. I don't think maybe there is a rare case of mentoring. I don't know it, but we don't know it. Yeah.
How do you see the leather community going forward?
Well, is there still a leather community? That's my question. I think that we must not forget leather has always been there. So, and BDSM, leather is not the word for what we do. We do BDSM, and we use leather to make that more attractive for us or for other people. So it's a meaning, not the reason. And the community, as we know it, leather bars, etc. When you look at the bigger picture, it has been, it started 50 years ago, roughly, don't pick me on the year, and now it has ended. So we have had a period of 50 years in which we had a community of people gathering and organizing themselves, which went up, and it was probably at the top. Okay, it became a different reason for health reasons because of HIV, so you had a top. And now, with the internet and smartphone, it has exploded into a myriad of little groups of interest. And so I don't think you can talk about the leather community. Leather or BDSM, I believe, will always be there. And it was there before the first leather bar, Siren, or what was it called in LA in the 40s. And it will also, even if there is no leather bar left, BDSM will be there because it is, well, I believe it is in your genes as well. You cannot, it's not bacterial or whatever, infectious. It's there, and when you have that, you will try to find other people. And it's also, thank God, more, people are more flexible now, because people have learned that BDSM is not only leather, and that was before HIV, you had this handbook, you couldn't combine leather with latex or whatever. You had this religion, this religion, and that has faded away, which is good. So it will all be there, but different.
What advice have you for people who are new to the scene?
That's difficult to say. It is. It's for everybody. It's for everybody. There is no advice. It's just don't believe everything you hear. Be critical. Try to meet people and play with people where you learn something from. Hopefully, you meet those people. There is no advice. We all had to learn. We all have had our encounters where we think, "Ooh, God, never again." And others where you think, "God, that was nice." And so it's difficult. There is no general advice to give, I think.
What are your personal fetishes?
Personal fetish. I have no personal fetish. I have too many fetishes.
The audience disagrees with you.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. What is my, well, then you need to define what a fetish is. Fetish is not the word, I think. But I like leather, I like rubber, but I'm not into special fetish, whatever, into, let's say, I'm into everything, almost everything.
What's your favorite?
No, there's no favorite. depends on the person, it depends on the, so you can have a wonderful time wearing a suit, you can have a wonderful time. That's it. You have to make the occasion be creative.
What's the biggest misconception about you?
That's an even more difficult question. I think that's difficult to answer because everybody will have a different view on anybody. So there are 1,000 different views of me, and I don't say I'm a public figure, but unfortunately, I'm sometimes in the limelight, and therefore I will be looked at. See, everybody has his own view of other people.
Yes.
And I cannot say for myself what the biggest misconception is. I'm very friendly. I don't buy, well, I do buy sometimes. But, yeah, it's, the interesting thing is that often, and that's why it's, you cannot answer this question, because everybody is different to them. And mostly when people see you or talk to you, they expect you to be the same as they are. And when you are, when you are not there, then you suddenly, so people look at, when people talk to other people, they expect something from the other person to act as they would do themselves. And when that doesn't stop with their view, then you're different. So, misconceptions.
Well, that concludes the formal interview. I would like to give you a very sincere and heartfelt